Welcome to my introduction to the field of quantum optics. Quantum optics is a subdiscipline within the physical sciences, and I have to tell you that it's going to be a very personalized view. I came from a particular direction of physics, got fascinated by what my colleagues and senior colleagues were studying, and I also wanted to do that kind of research. Quantum optics deals with the interaction of light and matter, but in a very special way. In fact, I have to tell you that quantum optics is nothing but a particular corner, a specialization of a much broader research background that we call quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics was developed or invented 100 years ago and describes generally what happens in nature, and it describes exactly what happens at the microscopic level of nature. It describes what atoms are and what is the dynamics of atoms and how they compose solid materials and how they cause the behavior that we can observe at larger scale. What is interesting about quantum optics is that it dives to the microscopic scale. In fact, it studies so simple systems and so simple dynamics that colleagues outside our field have sometimes looked with some suspicion. Is it really important? Is it really necessary? Is it really complicated what you're doing? But it is actually very complicated to isolate single atoms, and it is very interesting to see how single atoms are behaving, particularly in the laboratories when we expose them to our various controls and when we expose them to the measurements we can perform on them. I have to go back a little bit before the time of quantum optics. Quantum mechanics is a broad description of all microscopic physics. It emerged about 100 years ago, and it was initially introduced to describe atoms and molecules, solid state materials, chemistry, and today even into biophysics, the effects that we describe by quantum physics. Quantum physics is about describing nature. It's phenomena that happens around us. And one of the most important phenomena described early by Einstein and Bohr and German scientist Max Planck was actually the colors of light emitted by atoms. The colors of light you find from the stars, for example. And we know today that stars, our own sun, consist of particular species. And these species emit light with very precise frequencies. And we also know why, because the quantum theory explains why we have this particular frequencies of light. It's a very strange theory. It's a theory full of equations and mathematics. So it's not a theory like a hypothesis. It's actually a solid basis by which we understand quantum physics phenomena by atoms and molecules. But it's also a mathematically very abstract theory. Experimentally, I already mentioned that we are looking at the light coming from stars. We're also looking at a lot of objects in the laboratory. And what was characteristic is that the quantum theory describes microscopic phenomena, but the observations we made are typically on larger objects. It's on collections of many, many atoms, many, many molecules, and they all together are shining light, for example, out of our sun. And the field of quantum optics is characterized by studying the individual atom, the individual molecule. And there are many, many things that makes this a fascinating endeavor. So let me tell you one very important thing, namely that in quantum physics, the description is a probabilistic one. Things are not given with certainty, they're given with probabilities. So if you know not exactly what's going to happen if you do an experiment on a single particle, if you toss a coin, you don't know if it's going to be heads and tails or tails. If you do the experiment many, many times, you know what you will get on average. You know that if you toss a coin a million times, you'll get roughly 500,000 heads and 500,000 tails. And the early application of quantum theory was always this comparison of large numbers. And you would compare those large numbers with a prediction who would say 60% or 20% of the times you will measure this or that. So that was nice and fine, but the physicists were struggling to understand what happens in a single experiment. And it was a very, very abstract, but it was also a very hypothetical question, because it's difficult to do an experiment with a single atom, do experiments with single light sources. And this is actually, the founding element of quantum optics is the beginning of physics on these small systems. So what we are doing is we're doing the simplest system in the world, except it's very hard in the experiment to do that. And we are doing also the simple dynamics, namely solving for the dynamics of single and isolated particles. Some of the questions that came about was then immediately about the very founding elements of quantum physics. What does a single atom do? What does a single photon mean? The quantum of light, which is the whole founding element of quantum theory. And it's actually quite ironical that quantum physics was founded on the realization that light is quantized. Light being quantized means that when I'm hit by radiation, the light here in this room, there's actually a huge number of individual light particles that are hitting me. And every single light particle is what we call the quantum, has a definite energy that depends on the color of that particle. You cannot have half that energy because radiation is quantized in that unit. And that was a very important element in the understanding in the early quantum mechanics of why we see particular colors of light coming out from particular atoms. Later, it actually turned out in the quantum theory of the 1920s that light does not have to be quantized to come out with particular colors. The same way as a child on a swing will swing back and forth with a particular frequency, the atoms have their natural swinging frequencies, and that's actually what gives these colors to the light. But of course, the basic theory contains an element of quantization of light. And it was also one of the early tasks of quantum optics experiments to witness or maybe even explore and exploit this quantum nature of light. So quantum optics was going to the heart of finding the quanta in the light, in the optics, and experiments with single atoms emitting only one quantum at a time were established as late as in the 1970s and 1980s. Next followed on that, what could we do with such light? Are there applications of light? And you know probably that we use light for optical communication, but we also use light a lot for measurements, sensing. We are using lasers to probe things in the industry. We use light also to sense, for example, the blood streams. If you go to the hospital, they put a little clip with a light source in it. So there are many, many applications of light where the quantum nature of light may actually help and do things more precisely. I should also say that it's both the atoms and the light, and a quite famous physicist, Herbert Walther, a professor in Germany, was at some point asked, what is actually quantum optics? Because he was doing so many different things. And he said, and I really love this quote, he said, quantum optics, that's what I do. So quantum optics is actually what we do, the researchers who are brought up in this culture. And quantum optics has moved in many, many different directions. Some people study single molecules. Some are going back to more particles, but trying to create circumstances where the light coming out has very specific properties. We count the photons, or we make a state which has either one photon number or another one or both at the same time, one of the crazy elements of quantum mechanics. And finally, I should say that quantum optics is also about the control of these systems. So in fact, there's in a quantum optics laboratory, maybe just a single atom in the heart of the experiment, but around it there's a huge vacuum chamber to isolate it from the environment. Outside the vacuum chamber, there's a full table of laser mirrors and stuff that are providing all these different instruments we need to very delicately manipulate the single atom. So it's not necessarily small experiments we are talking about, but what is inside these experiments is very small. And all with the purpose to isolate, hold, and eventually even steer how single particles are evolving. I can give you a personal experience. I'm a theoretical physicist, so I don't have the joy of the light in the lab, but I'm always invited to laboratories. And a good colleague in Germany invited me to his ion trap lab. And in the dark of the lab, you can actually, with your naked eye, see the light from one single atom. So there's an electron being excited in the atom, and when it falls back to the ground state, it emits one photon at a time, and your eye can receive these photons, you can see it. Sometimes it got really dark, and that's because this atom found another state. Then I had a little button so I could put a little squeeze of light onto the atom and re-excite it so it came back again and started shining. So I felt a little bit like the master of the universe, a master of a very small universe, namely seeing a single atom emitting light and actually making that atom come back into this radiating state again. So this is something that is interesting and fun, but also has applications. On a final note, I just mentioned a huge topic, and we will not talk about that topic in detail, but in the last 10, 20, 25 years, we are talking about quantum information technologies, and we're doing it very seriously. We are talking about using these light sources to send single photon by photon information. This information is sent not at very high data rates, but it can be made completely confidential because you cannot break the photon. So either it arrives to the recipient untouched, or somebody steals it, but then you will notice that it has gone missing. So this is quantum key distribution or quantum cryptography. The atom emitters, because we are now so good at steering them, can be put simultaneously in different states at the same time, a facet of quantum theory, and they can now serve a role of what we call quantum bits. Not only bits that have value 0 and 1, but quantum bits who are 0 and 1. And there's a huge potential for computing and simulating physical properties of matter, but actually also simulating finance and do mathematical exercises on such quantum processes. I have to caution you, they don't exist. You can buy them, but you can still not do extremely useful tasks on them, but it's a big research project pursued internationally. So that's a very personalized quick run through a field of quantum optics. If you want to date it in time, I would say that we should date quantum optics maybe from the mid-late 60s, 1960s, and then it is still around in the laboratories. And in fact, many of the quantum information activities, quantum computing activities, my colleagues still refer to themselves as doing quantum optics in the laboratory, because they're still working on these single atoms and single light emitters.